Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is general questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, I would be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Alistair Allen.
I refer members to my register of interests, which mentions my involvement with Western Isles Cancer Care. To ask the Scottish Government what financial support is offered to patients and authorised escorts who need to travel significant distances for medical appointments.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Financial support for travel is available for patients and authorised escorts in line with eligibility criteria and medical requirements. We continue to work with boards to build on the significant innovation seen throughout the pandemic in order to reduce and limit the need for travel where possible and, of course, where clinically appropriate. For example, through increased use of digital and technological solutions such as Near Me. Where travel is necessary, boards are, of course, expected to support patients to identify and access support available, taking account of individual circumstances and ensuring, of course, that patient care is always at the centre of these decisions.
Alistair Allen.
The charity Western Isles Cancer Care Initiative recently recorded their fastest ever approval for financial assistance for a cancer patient who had a patient escort request for a friend to accompany them refused by the health board. For people who live on the mainland, it must be strange to imagine having to undergo something as worrying as cancer treatment without the support of a loved one. However, in the past few years, this has become an all-too-common scenario in the Western Isles since the handling of patient escort applications changed. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that patients shouldn't be disadvantaged in terms of the emotional support they can draw on just because they live on an island?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say I wholeheartedly agree with that point, and I think Alistair Allen articulates it very well, that for people on the mainland, you wouldn't expect to go through that situation, through that worry, through that anxiety on your own. And he makes a point that I think is very well made. I'm very sympathetic to the point that he makes in relation to not just cancer diagnosis, but of course any diagnosis that could potentially be life-altering. And so I will take this issue away and look at it in more detail. It would obviously come with a financial impact, but I think he is absolutely right to put patient care and patient safety at the heart of this. So I'm sympathetic to it, and I'll keep the member updated.
Rhoda Grant. Ms Grant, if I could ask you to pause for a moment as we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
We can indeed. Do continue.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've previously written to the Cabinet Secretary about this and I haven't received a reply. There was a review of patient travel in the Highlands and Islands take place, but was delayed since August last year because of the pandemic. So could I ask when that review will take place? Because it's urgently required. The criteria and reimbursement date back to 1996 and don't account for inflation. And would he also confirm that the review will be subject to an island impact assessment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I apologise if Ms Grant hasn't had a response to correspondence recently sent? I'll check that out as soon as we're out of the chamber. In terms of the wider point she makes, she's right. A review was due to be undertaken, but of course the pandemic unfortunately has meant that that has been delayed. So we will look to bring forward that review as soon as is possible. I hope she will understand. I'm sure she does understand that our boards and indeed our civil service team in health and social care are still under immense and intense pressure. In terms of the latter point she raises about any review undergoing an impact island impact assessment, I'll ensure that is the case.
Question number two, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to mitigate the effect that reduced access to physical activity during lockdown has had on the health of young people.
Minister Marie Todd.
Our approach during the pandemic has been to permit as much sport and physical activity as possible, and in particular prioritising under 18 sport, recognising the importance to both physical and mental health. When schools were closed during the pandemic, active school staff were deployed flexibly into childcare hubs to deliver sport and physical activity interventions, and also delivered online physical activity sessions for those learning from home. The Scottish Government has committed to doubling the budget for sport and active living over the lifetime of this Parliament, which will make access to sport and physical activity more inclusive, reduce barriers to participation, and play an important role in supporting long-term recovery from the pandemic.
Brian Whittle.
I thank that Minister for her answer. For 6 to 17-year-olds, the recommended daily exercise requirement is 60 minutes of moderate to vigorous activity. However, pre-lockdown, less than one quarter of children of that age group participated in that 60 minutes. Without question, and as I say this as a coach as well, that percentage has seriously declined in the last 2 years as access to activity has been significantly curtailed, especially in deprived areas. This will not be resolved without direct, targeted action and intervention from the Scottish Government. So can I ask the Minister what the Scottish Government will do to tackle this ticking health time bomb?
Minister.
Well, I thank the member for his continued interest in this area. We absolutely recognise the need to prioritise participation in across all groups, but also to tackle inequalities. And we are working with Sport Scotland, with organisations and individuals right across Scotland to break down the barriers, financial and otherwise, that keep too many people from leading active lives. We have ideas about how to increase participation from women and girls. We are looking at tackling the exclusion of people with disabilities. And we are very determined to increase the level of activity right across the board, but particularly focused on tackling inequalities in children and young people.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I preface this by saying I'm not promoting generational wars, but older people, and I declare an interest, not only have missed exercise, but many are still understandably cautious about being out and about in public, and they're losing confidence and becoming isolated. Can I ask the Minister also to give this consideration? And I'm talking about exercise, not sport, to which I am a stranger.
Minister.
And thank you very much for that question. And again, I acknowledge your ongoing interest in this area. Over 50s are a priority group for Sport Scotland's 21 to 25 equality outcomes. And there are a number of changes we're hoping to achieve in that particular area. We do want people to participate in sport. We want them to see and hear people participating in sport. We want to use their long experience and have them involved in organising sporting communities. But I guess one thing I will highlight in terms of activity, the Pass for All programme has the most amazing programmes, and one of them is called Health Walks. And it is exactly, as you say, about increasing the confidence of people who might have got out of the habit of exercising, who may have health worries that make them fear exercising, and offer a social opportunity. So I would heartily recommend all of my colleagues direct folk to go and have a look at Sport for All and at Pass for All, and there are fabulous opportunities for every age range to participate.
Question number three, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met Stirling Council and what was discussed.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Thank you. Ministers and officials have regular meetings with representatives of all Scottish local authorities, including Stirling Council, to discuss a wide range of issues as part of our commitment to working in partnership with local government to improve outcomes for the people of Scotland.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her reply. Community projects, high streets and tourist venues across the Stirling local government area have been severely impacted by the most recent and unnecessary restrictions imposed by the SNP. The vast majority are still waiting for assistance that has been promised by the Scottish Government. When will this be received and why the delay?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, a great deal of assistance has been set out during the course of the pandemic to support organisations that Dean Lockhart has outlined, and the Scottish Government has worked with partners to try and ensure that that money and support goes to local projects as quickly as possible. And I know certainly from my own engagement from the third sector organisations that I have engaged with, that has been very warmly welcomed and has enabled them to support people in our communities, particularly the most vulnerable.
Question number four, Michael Mara. Question number four, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what its plans are for service continuity for breast cancer oncology services in NHS Tayside in light of reports of further resignations within the service.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
On the 20th of January this year, NHS Tayside announced that due to a staffing gap which will arise at the end of January, a mutual aid agreement has been agreed between NHS Tayside and three other health boards. The agreement outlines that some patients living in Tayside and receiving radiotherapy for breast cancer will be required to travel for their treatment to the nearest cancer centre in Edinburgh, Glasgow or Aberdeen. All other radiotherapy services in Dundee Cancer Centre will carry on locally. Meanwhile, recruitment for any vacant posts within the service is ongoing.
Michael Mara.
I can inform Parliament and the Minister that over recent days there have been two further resignations of consultant oncologists. This will leave NHS Tayside with no breast cancer oncology specialists and serious shortfalls in oncology consultant cover for other tumour sites. Putting aside the government and Health Quangos incompetence that got us here, I implore on behalf of the women of Dundee and Tayside that the Minister at long last treat this as the crisis it is. Will the Minister immediately intervene to guarantee the full service recovery of breast cancer services in Dundee?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'll not rise to the political attacks. I think it's important to engage, of course, in this issue in a non-partisan way. I think it is important that we put the women and the patients who are affected by this very much at the heart of this. When he asks that if I will intervene, I can give him an absolute assurance that I and the other ministerial colleagues have been deeply involved in this issue. What I would say is there's no question that NHS Tayside hasn't been taking action. They have been taking action. I'll just give them some examples. NHS Tayside undertook three rounds of recruitment last year with one successful applicant. They've been in regular contact with all UK agencies, in fact more than 120 in total for both contracted and non-contracted posts. Medical directors have been in contact with several of the larger cancer centres in England who are reporting similar challenges. So yes, we will absolutely work closely with Tayside. It is of course a deeply regrettable situation that they are in, and we will do everything we can to ensure that NHS Tayside breast cancer service is staffed in the best possible way. But I should say that the issue of the shortage of medical oncologists, particularly for breast cancer, is not unique to Tayside. It is felt, in this case, extremely felt, acutely felt in Tayside, but it is an issue that is wider than simply Tayside. I'm, of course, happy to meet with members on this issue because it will take a collective effort by the Government and the Health Board to ensure that we have a full service resumed in Tayside.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. NHS Tayside's inability to recruit replacement breast therapy and clinicians is putting a huge strain on individuals, especially when they have early stage breast cancer. And you've identified, Cabinet Secretary, that people are going to Glasgow, Aberdeen and even Forth Valley, and all of these themselves have staffing issues. So what additional measures can be put in place to ensure that the disruption to these patients is kept to a minimum?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Alexander Stewart is absolutely right that the focus is to try to ensure that the disruption is kept to an absolute minimum. So I should say, and Tayside have made this very clear, of course, that where there is the need to travel and, of course, to be accommodated, then, of course, NHS Tayside will seek to make sure those costs are covered. What I would say to the member is that we're working intensively with the board to support all further solutions. That includes international recruitment, it includes regional roles which support several centres such as Lothian and Tayside. It looks at locum capacity being re-examined, including international locum agencies that we're dealing with, role redesign, including research opportunities with Dundee Medical School, and exploring an enhanced marketing campaign for Tayside to attract more oncologists, breast cancer oncologists in particular, to Tayside. But this is an issue that, although we're rightly focusing on Tayside and understandably so, it is felt by not just other health boards in Scotland, but in other health boards and I know in NHS Trusts in England and other parts of the UK. So we will do everything we possibly can to ensure that our breast cancer services across Scotland are fully staffed.
Question number 5, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans for a national care service.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The consultation on the National Care Service received over 1,300 responses. Analysis of the responses is currently underway, and we expect to be able to publish a report on the findings as soon as possible. I'm sure you'll appreciate that the final timetable will be driven by the ability to prepare easily accessible versions, both written and audible versions. And given the breadth of the consultations, ministers across government will want time to reflect on the analysis. As such, there is no plan for a concurrent government response.
Jenny Minto.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Can the Minister confirm whether Good Food Nation plans would be relevant to the formation of the National Care Service?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Ms Minto for that question. We want Scotland to be a good food nation where people from every walk of life take pride and pleasure in and benefit from the food they produce, buy, cook, serve and eat each day. And we'll consider how to take account of the Good Food Nation principles in the National Care Service as we develop our proposals.
Question number 6, Rona Mackay.
Apologies, Presiding Officer, thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Yes, boards, chairs and chief executives this morning, and that included NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Rona Mackay.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. I've been contacted by a registered blind constituent who's asking what lateral flow test help is available for visually impaired people. Is the Health Board and the Scottish Government aware of the difficulties encountered by people with this disability and what help is available to them?
Cabinet Secretary.
I am aware of these issues, and I know a number of members have raised them, and Rona Mackay raises a really important point indeed. The UK Health and Security Agency, who primarily deliver the national testing programme, they are continually exploring ways, and we are working with them to explore ways to enable testing to be more accessible. So for people with access to a smartphone, the UK COVID-19 testing programme launched the Be My Eyes support service in early 2021 to improve accessibility for at-home PCR testing. In response to calls for the same support for LFD at-home testing, an expansion to the existing 119 Be My Eye service was launched, the 119 Be My Eye service was launched today on the 27th of January to assist asymptomatic visually impaired people and anyone else who needs support to conduct a rapid flow self-test independently. So if you have severe sight loss, you might find it easier to get help to do that test, of course, from a friend or family, but I understand, of course, not everybody is in that position. In addition, instructions for the use of LFD self-tests used in the national testing programme, they are available in large print and also in easy read, and they can be accessed at the appropriate manufacturer's links. I think our communication around this, I will ensure, is on our NHS Inform websites, but we'll also work with those third sector partners as well to make sure that this new expansion to this BMII service is the information is widely available.
Question number 7, Kenneth Gibson.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implementation of its endoscopy and urology diagnostic recovery and renewal plan.
Cabinet Secretary.
Endoscopy and Urology Diagnostic Recovery and Renewal Plan was published on the 30th of November. Actions in the plan are on track. We've committed to annual updates on progress against commitments in this in the NHS Recovery Plan, the first of which will be later this year.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The plan contains a commitment to set up several diagnostic urology hubs and a one-stop clinics across Scotland to reduce waiting times for cancer and routine diagnosis. One such hub was set up in NHS Highland in June last year. What arrangements are being made to ensure people in Ayrshire have access to a diagnostic urology hub or one-stop clinic within NHS Ayrshire and Arran, and when will such a unit open?
Cabinet Secretary.
Ayrshire and Arran currently have a urology hub and cancer performance for the urology 62-day pathway is 96.9% and for the 31-day pathway is 100%. Through time, as we develop further develop the urology diagnostic hubs, we hope the full benefits of the hubs will be realised and will reduce waiting times for cancer patients. And as I say, we intend to give annual updates on that. And I'll ensure, of course, if local members want local information about the support and the actions we're taking in their local health board area, then I will, of course, be happy to provide that information.